So I welcome Dr. Mamta Manglani madam. This is the third lecture of Dr. Mamta Manglani madam. We all know that Dr. Mamta Manglani madam is a well-known pediatric hemato-oncologist, and right now she is the director of MCGM Comprehensive Thalassemia Care Pediatric Hematology Oncology and BMT Center Borivali. And she is also the chairperson of current IPPHO chapter.
Thank you, Preeti, and thank you, Shishir and Prasanna, for again giving me an opportunity to be with your people and share my thoughts on neonatal anemia today. So I think without delay, we will start. So I'm able to connect with you all every fortnightly so that I can share my knowledge with everybody. Talking about anemia, as we born baby is not the same as in a fetus. So usually the yolk sac and the pre-amniotic sac, these are the areas where hematopoiesis takes place. But as a fetus grows, in the late first trimester itself, liver takes over, and in the third trimester, bone marrow overlaps with the liver. Thymus, of course, is activated for T lymphocyte formation, and then you have the complete bone marrow taking over after birth. But in a preterm baby, because the gestational age is somewhere here, the liver still continues to remain active and the bone marrow is still not completely taken over. Of course, in the adults, we know long bones are the main site of hematopoiesis. And just to again mention that very often we need to give intrauterine transfusion through cordosynthesis procedure when babies have hydrops-like phenomena and anemia in utero. Now, what happens to the hemoglobins in the fetus and neonate? It's a very simple way to remember that the alpha chains are persistent since the beginning till we die. And delta chains, which form the alpha 2 delta 2 hemoglobin A2, again, starts in the late gestation, but then persists in the same amount throughout life. What changes mainly is the fetal chains, that is the gamma chains, the fetal hemoglobin alpha 2 gamma 2. That drops as soon as the baby takes breath because oxygenation starts. And then you do not need a high affinity chain like gamma chain or the alpha 2 gamma 2 hemoglobin to retain, extract oxygen from the mother's placenta and then have high hemoglobin so that you can give adequate oxygenation. That's why you have very high hemoglobin in utero. If you had low hemoglobin in utero, the affinity of gamma chains is so high to oxygen that it will not release enough oxygen to the tissues. So therefore, nature has devised high affinity hemoglobin F, that is alpha 2 gamma 2, for being able to deliver enough oxygen in higher concentration you keep the hemoglobin, and these chains can extract the oxygen from the mother's placenta very well because they have a high affinity for oxygen. But as soon as we take a breath at birth, the oxygen needs drop because now the lungs are getting enough oxygen and extraction of oxygen is not very difficult. And therefore, there is a switchover mechanism where beta chains start becoming more predominant and gamma chains start dropping. The hemoglobin F drops, the hemoglobin A takes over. So around at birth, you have 30% hemoglobin A and 70% hemoglobin F. But as you can see, the complete switch takes place by 6 months, wherein you hardly have 1 to 2% of hemoglobin F, but you have hemoglobin A almost to the tune of 95%. And about 2 to 3% is the alpha 2 delta 2, that is the hemoglobin A2. So in a postnatal life, you initially have hemoglobin F also in a higher concentration, about between anything between 1 to 2 at 6 months to 70% in a full-term baby. It could be up to 80 to 90% in a preterm baby because a preterm baby will be born here, somewhere here. So it will be higher. When you are looking at hemoglobin F normal values, always look at the normogram for first 4 months specially. And then only decide whether this patient has an abnormal hemoglobin F. That is the purpose I have shown this graph in the beginning, so that we are aware of how to interpret the hemoglobin F. There are many variables which affect the hematological values in a baby. the blood collection site of sampling. If it is capillary blood, it is different cutoff for anemia. If it is venous sample, it will be different. The time of sampling, suppose the baby is, you're taking cord blood, it will be different. Day one will be different. Day seven will be different, because baby is so dynamically changing. The physiologic processes in a neonate are so many that we do not have the same parameters applicable over the first 15 days to 1 month. They keep changing. Treatment of umbilical vessels. If you have milked the umbilical vessels, your hemoglobin can be higher. If you do not, then it will be lower. If you have clamped the umbilical cord faster, then you will have anemia in the baby to some extent. If you clamp delayed, then you will have good hemoglobin in the baby. And in fact, now the WHO guidance is that you must clamp, have a delayed clamping and not early clamping, except in certain conditions like HIV. Gestational age again matters, because as I showed you, the changes are dynamic and therefore you will have to take care of the gestational age. Now, neonatal erythrocyte is a, as I said, neonatal period is the most dynamic period. There's a transition from the hypoxic intrauterine to independent neonatal life. And therefore the switch, I think everybody needs to mute their, because there are people talking. Can I have them mute themselves? Yeah, thank you. So the transition from hypoxic intrauterine to independent neonatal life happens, which I just explained, that how the hypoxia needs hemoglobin F for extraction of the oxygen, and because delivery of oxygen will also be compromised, so you need a higher hemoglobin concentration, whereas in post-neonatal period or postnatal period, you do not need that. Etiology of anemia is varied in neonates. There are many maternal influences like nutrition, illness, etc., which we must not forget when having a neonate in front of us. A neonate cannot be independently evaluated. It has to be evaluated in conjunction with the mother, as mother-baby are single unit as far as we pediatricians are concerned. So what are the maternal-fetal relationship aspects? So iron, folate, B12, these are all passed on from the mother to the baby. As we all know, maximum iron transport happens in the third trimester. So if the baby is born prematurely, it is born with a lower store of iron from the mother. It is already a compromised baby. Folate is not that important, because folate stores do not last long. So even if there are shorter stores, we need to anyway be supplementing from outside through nutrition, through feeding. So mother's milk is adequate, and therefore folate deficiency is not commonly noticed in newborn or even paraneonate period. B12 again is a very important nutrient which is passed on from mother to baby, and if adequate stores are not created in the baby can become deficient from 2 months onwards, and therefore sometimes we see the infantile tremor syndrome or the nutritional tremor syndrome along with megaloblastic anemia, which occurs in early infancy, about 2 to 3 months onwards, and it can be easily corrected by just supplementing B12. Maternal infections like malaria, causing congenital malaria in the baby, leading to anemia. Torches, again, all of us know, can lead to anemia, thrombocytopenia, cytopenias, as well as hepatosplenomegalies, retinitis, and it can have various other defects like cardiac defects, cataracts. I'm not going into details because that's not really our focus today. HIV, as we all know, can compromise the baby's nutrition, can cause baby getting infected in utero, and therefore there can be a small for gestational age baby, a premature delivery, and a low birth weight baby. And all this can have compromised nutrition because mother's nutrition may be compromised. Various drugs can affect by bleeding in the baby, and maternal diseases. Phenytoin can also lead to a megaloblastic type anemia. Maternal diseases can impact the baby, and baby may manifest with certain manifestations like anemia and thrombocytopenia if mother has SLE and the antibodies are passed to the baby. If there is an autoimmune hemolytic anemia in the mother, which also happens in SLE, even that antibody will get transmitted to the baby, and therefore baby can be also manifesting an autoimmune hemolysis. Of course, malignancies generally do not directly affect the baby, but it can lead to problems because mother may be on chemotherapy and therefore she may be nutritionally again deprived because of lack of appetite, vomiting, etc. And therefore one needs to be, just a minute. So these are the aspects which you need to keep in mind when mother is being treated for malignancy. She undergoes surgery, she undergoes chemotherapy, she undergoes various other treatments, radiation. And that can all impact the nutrition of the mother and therefore breastfeeding, and therefore the baby's nutrition can also be compromised. Heart disease during pregnancy always gives rise to a low birth weight baby because hypoxia is a problem. Hyperthyroidism, you can have thyroid being the hormone getting passed on to the baby, and that can lead to, or antibodies getting passed on, and therefore it can lead to hyper or hypothyroidism in the baby also. Diabetes, we all know infant of diabetic mother can have certain complications. So we must keep in mind when we are taking a history whether mother is healthy and mother does not have any of these issues. The fetus takes its mother for better or for worse in sickness and in health. You know, this is the way the fetus and the mother are a single unit. How do we define anemia in a neonate? A cord or venous blood hemoglobin of less than 13 gram percent, a capillary hemoglobin of less than 14.5 gram percent, and or a venous hematocrit of less than 45%. This defines anemia in a neonate. Any neonate which is a full term neonate. If it is a preterm neonate, you will have to match with the parameters for a particular gestational age on the charts that are available. In Nathan Oski textbook of your pediatric hematology oncology, you can get all these charts. I've just picked up these from the same book from Nathan Oski, and you can see that the effect of gestational age on of fetuses in utero and newborn infants on hematocrit, hemoglobin, MCV and reticulocytes. So as you can see, 18 to 20 weaker hemoglobin is low, but as they grow to 26 to 28 weeks, it goes to 19, and it remains nearly 18 to 19 till term. And MCV again is high in the in utero and drops to about 120 average, but it can be up to 130. Reticulocytes also, they are high in the in utero period during 26 to 28 weeks, and they drop to 3.2 plus or minus bit. Not to worry about that. About 5% reticulocyte is normal in a normal newborn. So normal hematologic values also dynamically change during the first year of life. So when you're looking at a baby who's just 2 weeks old versus 1 month old versus 2 months old, there's a dramatic difference, because by 2 months or 8 to 12 weeks is the physiologic anemia of infancy. That is in those full-term babies who have a normal hematopoiesis happening, but because they are now switching from fetal hemoglobin to adult hemoglobin, they do not need a very high level. So the erythropoietin feedback is reduced and the threshold is made higher, and therefore your hemoglobin drops. And once they drop to the nadir, erythropoietin stimulation restarts and they again start picking up to a little bit to up to 12. So a baby who is 2 months old is different from a baby who is 15 days old. One can't, or a baby who is just born. One can't extrapolate the hemoglobin values from one to the other. Similarly, hematocrit, RBC count, MCH, MCV, everything changes with time. And you can see everything nearly normalizes by 4 months of age. So what is the etiology of anemia in newborn generally? I mean, in an older child, suppose an infant comes to us, we think of nutritional anemia very easily. And first we will start iron and wait and watch. If within 2 weeks they don't respond, then we think, okay, now we should refer to this patient to a higher center. But in a neonate, nutritional anemia is almost always unknown, or rather it is never seen. I have hardly seen nutritional anemia in a newborn. You may have iron deficiency anemia due to chronic hemorrhage, but it's not nutritional in origin. So you have to differentiate between the two. So hemorrhage is one of the commonest reasons for anemia in newborn, followed by hemolysis and very rarely impaired red cell production. So I think anemia and neonate actually is very simple. It can be easily diagnosed if we remember this principle that you do not have nutritional anemia coming, you have these three classifications. Yes, the reasons for these can vary, which I will come to in the later slides. So let me start with a case. And this is an interesting case. Some of you might have already heard me speak on this case in the talk I gave for Awesome some 1 month ago. But if you have not heard, you will be more, you'll enjoy it more. So this was a G1P1 mother who underwent elective cesarean section for a twin delivery. Her first male baby cried immediately after birth. And I'll just push this a little so that, yeah. And weighed 2.4 kgs. Her second baby was a female, weighed lower, 1.5 kgs, did not cry after birth, required bag and mask, cried after 20 seconds. There was no asphyxia as such, but did not cry spontaneously after birth. Now, the second baby was found very pale. The cord blood tested 7.2 gram percent, which is quite pale. And the baby did not cry after birth. So there is some issue. There were no obvious antenatal complications in the mother. No antepartum hemorrhage, abruptio placentae, no fever with rashes or malaria-like fever. No history of any drugs except the hematinics, which are given normally to any mother. No history suggestive of autoimmune phenomena. So there was really nothing much in the mother to worry about. And on examination, this baby was lethargic with tachycardia and tachypnea, suggestive that this is an acute event and not a chronic event. Was severely pale. There was no edema. Again, suggestive that this is acute event. If you have a chronic anemia, you will get cardiac failure. You will get edema. Here, there was not really much of cardiac failure. This was more like a shock phenomena, hypotension. And there was no evidence of placental hemorrhage or retroplacental clot. Now, because this baby was born in a hospital, this was a VIP mother, first of all, was referred to us because she was our colleague. And the gynecologist took extra care because immediately as soon as they saw the baby was pale, they went back and looked at the placenta and there was no placental hemorrhage or retroplacental clot. I want to make this one point to all of us who are pediatricians managing cesarean sections or even normal deliveries as a pediatrician attending them. We should not forget to ask the gynecologist or obstetrician to check on the placenta every time for whatever findings there might be, which we may not require or utilize later on. But in case the baby has a complication, we will have information available to us, which will help us in making a diagnosis correctly. Because if you see a placental hemorrhage or a retroplacental clot, you don't have to work up the baby at all. You know it's a bleeding. There was no bleeding from any other site in the baby, no cephalohematoma, meaning even umbilical cord, rupture of umbilical cord or any bruising of umbilical cord was not there. So there was no bleeding from that site, no cephalohematoma, no other skin bleeds, no congenital malformations. So this was a normal baby otherwise, low birth weight. One of the twins had tachycardia and tachypnea at birth. Was severely pale, cord blood hemoglobin was only 7.2. There was no liver spleen palpable. Again, suggesting this is not a chronic hemorrhage. This is not a chronic anemia. Chronic anemias will give rise to liver spleen palpable. No signs of cardiac failure. So again, suggestive that this is not a chronic bleed. Respiratory system, there was nothing except tachypnea. And neonatal reflexes were present and NIBP was on the lower side. So naturally, this was the baby. This is the twin of the, this baby is the female baby who was low birth weight and pale. This is the pinker baby. And this is the way the baby looked in the intensive care. So what were the possibilities? Obviously, we said hemorrhage or hemolysis. These are the two common ones. There is hardly a third reason for acute anemia in a newborn. Hemolysis would have given us jaundice by and large. Very rarely you will have no jaundice in a hemolysis. If the hemolysis is significantly intravascular, very acute, you will not see jaundice. But if it is a little slower hemolysis and is extravascular, you will definitely see bilirubin being formed, indirect bilirubin being high. So your hemorrhage was a major possibility. So what would we do? We would investigate this baby. We would do a CBC personality count, blood group of baby and mother. Serum bilirubin is important because we must look at whether there is an increased bilirubin. And of course, SOS, if we feel there is a blood group incompatibility, then, or even if you don't find blood group incompatibility, but jaundice is present, then LDH and DCT, ICT will help you to confirm that there is a hemolysis due to antibodies which are present in the mother. Because the baby has sensitized the mother with that antigen during pregnancy, and now she's passed the antibody to the baby, and the baby's blood is being destroyed, or the RBCs are being destroyed. Now, this was a CBC. I'm sorry for the bad report, because there was so much scribbling done by the pediatrician over there, who's also a hematologist, because she wanted to be sure of what she's looking at. So the cord blood CBC, as you can see, showed a hemoglobin of 7.2 and a MCV which is normal or a little higher side. So that shows again that this was not a chronic bleed. If it was a chronic bleed, your MCV will be like an iron deficiency. But in a newborn, it will be say 100 or 95, not very low. Now platelets were normal. Other parameters were okay. There was polychromasia. Nucleated RBCs were 60 per 100 WBCs. And also, retic count was on the higher side. The MCV was also high because there was so much of nucleated RBCs, and because the bone marrow was stressed because the baby was losing blood. Now, you look at the cord blood of the other twin, 15 gram hemoglobin, MCV is 104, 270,000 platelets, hardly a 9 per 100 WBCs is the nucleated red cells. Very normal CBC. Now look at the first baby's blood collected after birth. And again, 7.8 gram hemoglobin, 124 MCV, and nucleated RBC 64. So definitely an acute bleed should be considered in this case. This was how the picture looked. So there was nothing significantly abnormal. Few target cells in low birth weight babies, preterm babies, you may get. But otherwise, nothing significantly abnormal. Retic was 6.2%, which was on the higher side. DCT, ICT was negative. Blood group of baby mother were B positive. So there was no RH or ABO incompatibility. But you cannot rule out a minor group incompatibility, which includes many other blood group systems like KEL, Duffy, KID, P system, the Lutheran system, the MNS system, etc. But we do not test for these groups, but we can indirectly know that there is a minor group incompatibility if the Coombs test comes positive, or there is a very high reticulocyte count, spherocytes on the smear, then we know again that this seems to be an immune hemolysis. On inquiring, they were dizygotic twins with separate placenta. Just excuse me for a second. Sorry. And dizygotic twins. So there was no question of twin to twin transfusion. You must remember this also, because that can itself be a reason for anemia in one of the babies and the good hemoglobin in the other. And what would help us to differentiate that? I'll come to that. So what is the further test to be done? Someone is using the whiteboard by mistake. Please erase it, otherwise it looks really bad. So the next test we would do is Cleor-Betke test to look at fetomaternal bleed. And what is this Cleor-Betke test? It's an acid elution, or you use alkali resistant fetal cells. So you use on the smear a stain which has alkali, and that will allow the adult cells to look like ghosts, whereas fetal cells will resist it, and therefore it will not they will not be ghost-like, they will be pink. Now, it showed 430 fetal cells out of 12,000 maternal cells. What does this mean? 3.6% of the blood, of the cells were fetal cells in the mother. And if you look at the amount of blood that the baby has lost, it's 86 ml. This is a formula to calculate 2400 into ratio of fetal to maternal cells, and this is how we calculated it. It is 86 ml. So baby had lost 86 ml blood, which is almost 50% of her blood volume. 165 should be her blood volume. So you can imagine so much of the blood was lost into the mother that the baby had become significantly pale. Now, this is how the Cleor Betke looks. These are fetal cells and these are maternal cells. Maternal cells, because they get lysed by the alkali, the hemoglobin gets denatured, whereas these fetal cells will resist the denaturation. How will we manage this baby? Should we transfuse or wait to make a perfect diagnosis? No, we can't wait. We had to transfuse this baby immediately. So baby was transfused twice, and initially 5 ml followed by 10 ml because she was very low hemoglobin, and was started on iron after 3 weeks of birth because she has lost blood. We don't want to keep pumping blood. And this is how the baby looked at 3 years of age, and now at 5 years of age, started going to school. There's hardly a difference between the two twins. Excuse me. So types of hemorrhage in the newborn, we all are aware there can be occult hemorrhage prior to delivery. One of them is fetomegaly. You can have due to various reasons. I'm not going to give you the details. It can be spontaneous. And this is how Cleor Betke will help. And you can have twin-to-twin transfusion, but this will happen in monozygotic twins and not in a dizygotic twin. So fetal transfusion occurs in monozygotic twins with monochorionic placentae. 15 to 33% of twins will have this problem. The difference in hemoglobin value should be somewhere around 5 g/cl in the two twins. You can see one is pink, one is pale, but doesn't look a difference of more than 5, so may not be a twin-to-twin transfusion. And baby will be born with anemia shock and can be a stillborn. And recipient will be polycythemic, have hyperviscosity, have hyperbilirubinemia. Now, types of hemorrhage in the newborn further can be internal hemorrhage, like intracranial. You can have giant cephalhematoma. Caput succedaneum is not a bleed. It is just a fluid collection. You can have retroperitoneal, ruptured liver, ruptured spleen, which can be very bad, and iatrogenic. And this is where we are guilty. How much blood we keep drawing in NICU? We do not even keep a chart, and we do not realize that the baby's blood volume is so limited, being a small baby, that even drawing, say, 20 ml can be significant, 20 to 30 ml, and which we would be doing cumulatively over days. So we have to keep a bloodlet chart always in NICUs.
Hello.
Another case that was interesting. A two-day-old baby was referred to us for anemia and petechiae. On antenatal history, mother had rashes over legs for 4 months. So I don't know whether you can see clearly, but she was given just local creams, saying that this was just allergic rash, not investigated. On examination, the baby was in congestive cardiac failure with severe pallor, petechial rash, ecchymosis, and mother was also pale and had petechial rash over the lower limbs. So the hemoglobin of the baby was 6.5, mother's was 5.7, and both had low platelet counts also. We sent other investigations, but meanwhile, the diagnosis that was made by us is that if the mother and baby both have anemia and thrombocytopenia, it's likely an antibody-mediated problem. So SLE in the mother was the first consideration. And we got ANA, anti-DNA positive in both mother and baby. APLA and ACLA were negative. LA was positive. So this was a typical SLE. Can person who's speaking, can you mute yourself and speak, please? Excuse me. So treatment, would you give platelet transfusions? Would you give packed cell transfusions? Not really, unless it is an emergency to tide over the crisis. So here, because the platelet count was very low, yes, platelets were given, but they won't help because they are antibody mediated destruction. So what would work is steroids and IVIG. Steroids work better in SLE, and therefore steroids were started in both the baby and the mother, and both became better. So another case which I would like to share with you. So this was a hemolytic type of anemia along with thrombocytopenia. This case is a 6-day-old male child, full-term normal vaginal delivery, cried immediately after birth. Birth weight was 2.7 kgs. I think people have to understand that they're disturbing if they are talking with unmute. Who is this person speaking so much? Please teach him how to mute. So this baby was a full-term normal delivery, cried immediately after birth. Birth weight was 2.7 kgs, was referred for anemia and deepening icterus on day 2. And since day 2, she had hyperbilirubinemia with a indirect bilirubin of 27 milligram percent on day 2. CBC was hemoglobin of 11 gram percent, MCV 102, MCH 28, MCHC was 38% and RDW was 18%. So now what we need to look at is hemoglobin is low, MCHC is high, MCV is nearly normal, and RDW is slightly increased. Whereas hyperbilirubinemia significantly indirect has been noticed on day 2. Now the baby is 6 days old. So further investigations were done. Mother and babies, obviously we were thinking of something that is happening in the baby with hemolysis because the indirect bilirubin was very high. So obviously the first thing that you need to rule out is ABO-RH incompatibility, minor group incompatibility. So we did mother's and baby's blood group. Both were O positive, so there was no ABO-RH incompatibility. Retic count was very high with a retic production index of 4. And 4 means hemolysis, which is again confirmed. LDH was high. G6PD was done because this baby was a male baby. It was normal. But as you know, when you have a very high retic count, G6PD can come normal because reticulocytes have a higher content of G6PD enzyme. DCT, ICT were negative. LDH was high. So there was hemolysis. We don't know why. The ABO incompatibility and RH incompatibility were ruled out, and G6PD was all nearly ruled out, but DCT, ICT were negative. So minor group incompatibility also seemed to be lower chance. Therefore, we looked at the peripheral smear, and this is what we found, spherocytes. But spherocytes can be positive even in an autoimmune hemolysis or an isoimmune hemolysis. But of course, this was with DCT negative, spherocytes significantly present. So we thought of doing the osmotic fragility test, which showed an enhanced osmotic fragility. As you can see, the hemolysis is beginning at a higher concentration of sodium chloride and almost ending at 0.3-0.4%. So this is typical increased osmotic fragility. What further the test you would do? Test, of course, you should do flow cytometry to confirm hereditary spherocytosis. You can do the genetic testing for various mutations. 5 gene mutations are at least known now for spectrin, alpha spectrin, beta spectrin, ankyrin, band 3, and protein 4.2. These 5 are known mutations. But okay, we can just go into further details in the family because it's an autosomal dominant inheritance. It's very crucial to look at all the family members. So ask history of jaundice, spleen palpable in any family members should be noted. Any history of transfusions in any family member, splenectomy or cholecystectomy in any family member, this would help. And neonatal hyperbilirubinemia to an incidental spleen in a grandfather is how the spectrum of hereditary spherocytosis is. So one must be really careful in taking the pedigree chart up to 2-3 generations before this baby and chart it properly. How would you treat this patient? Immediate treatment would be red cell transfusions if the pallor is significant, exchange transfusion if hyperbilirubinemia, and definitely folate supplementation. Further treatment in the future, if hemoglobin drops below 8 g/cent, red cell transfusion should be given. If there is a drop which is significant regularly, then regular transfusions be given. If patient becomes transfusion dependent, then after 6 years, a splenectomy must be planned. And prior to that, all the vaccines for encapsulated organisms like pneumococcal, HIB vaccine, meningococcal vaccine, these should be definitely given. And post-splenectomy, we would give penicillin prophylaxis. Lifelong is what we recommend, but some books say you can give for 5 years post-splenectomy. Now, this is this was a case of hereditary spherocytosis presenting as neonatal hyperbilirubinemia with pallor with 11 g hemoglobin. And as you saw, case was in a neonate and diagnosed in neonate. Now I'm going to show you one case which was not diagnosed though there was neonatal hyperbilirubinemia, and what was this condition. So here was a 5-year-old boy. I know it's neonatal anemia, and yet we are talking of this 5-year-old because the presentation was dating back to neonatal period. Born of non-consanguineous marriage, first by birth order, Hindu by religion, resident of Chandrapur, presented to us in January 2018. History dates back to neonatal period when he had severe jaundice but was given only double surface phototherapy. And at 4 months of age, he developed fever and lethargy when they tested him. And that time, his CBC showed hemoglobin, which was very low, 4.8 g/cent, with a 83 MCV, white cell counts were normal, and platelets were normal. He received his first transfusion at that time, but no diagnosis was given to him. He again received packed red cell transfusion on 3 more occasions in June 2014, November, and January 2015. And now in 18, he came to us. He was normal developmentally, immunized, adequate mixed diet, and was low socioeconomic class. Presently, he came with pallor, fever, lethargy since 15 days and went to another hospital first, developed red colored urine during hospital stay there. Enzymopathy was suspected as a cause of intravascular hemolysis, and he was investigated for G6PD, GPI, pyruvate kinase and 5-nucleotidase. All above enzyme studies were normal. He was referred to us then due to non-affordability, as the earlier hospital where he was being treated was a private hospital. So he came to us for further workup and management. So there was history of neonatal hyperbilirubinemia where he received phototherapy for 3 days, no jaundice later, no history of passing dark colored urine in the past, no history of recurrent jaundice, anemia, gallstones in parents, history of sickle cell disease in family. On examination, he was vital stable, pallor significant, mild icterus, frontal bossing, no edema, lymphadenopathy, no clubbing or nail changes, spine skin joints were normal, dental caries were present, and he had a liver and spleen palpable. So liver was 2 cm and spleen was 4 cm and no other systems were involved. Now, when you look at his serial blood counts since 4 months of age, 4.8 hemoglobin, November 13, so about 10 months of age, 6.1, 22 months, 5.9, and 24 months, 4.8, and at our place, 6.3. Now, very clearly, the MCV has been nearly normal all the time. A normocytic, normochromic anemia with very significant hemoglobin drop. This is typical of a hemolytic. Congenital hemolytic anemia, and therefore we thought of that congenital hemolytic anemia. His retic count was 8% with a corrected of 3.6, and retic production index was 1.8. It is close to 2, so hemolysis should be considered. This is the CBC at our place, 6.3 g hemoglobin, MCV 84, and you can now look at the peripheral smear findings. Hypo, micro, macro, helmet cells, teardrop cells, basophilic stippling, and anisocytosis, all kinds of changes were present. And this is how it looked. But on retic smear, we found Heinz bodies. And this is typical of an enzymopathy. And therefore, we thought of doing further workup for enzyme studies. LDH was high. So again, confirming hemolysis. Of course, bilirubin was not very elevated. So red cell enzyme studies, which were already done, pyruvate kinase, glucose phosphate, isomerase, pyridine 5-nucleotidase, and G6PD, these were normal. Urine for hemosiderin was positive, suggesting intravascular hemoglobinuria, intravascular hemolysis. DCT, ICT was negative, haptoglobin was low, and HPLC was normal. So hemosiderin present, haptoglobin low, and LDH high with mild icterus and significant pallor. All this favors intravascular hemolysis in a child. So the differential diagnosis was rare enzymopathies, AIHA, but DCT-ICT was negative, so less likely, though you can have a Coombs negative autoimmune hemolytic anemia and unstable hemoglobins, which can lead to intravascular hemolysis. So sample was sent to NIIH to process for rare enzymopathies by NGS and to look for unstable hemoglobins. Meanwhile, we gave him packed cell transfusion, intravenous fluids with mannitol because he had hemoglobinuria. We also gave prednisolone to prevent the acute tubular necrosis. Started on folate, improved with above management. He was discharged on folate, zinc, and multivitamins, and he was looking good when he was discharged. And then we got the report from NIIH, and that showed the adenylate kinase deficiency. And he was compound heterozygote for that. Means he had two genes inherited from mother and father, two different genetic mutations in the AK1 gene. Now, we did his family screening. Actually, NIIH followed up and went personally to the village of the child, worked up their extended family members for these mutations. 8 out of 32 family members had a single allele mutation. None of them had compound heterozygous mutations or a homozygous mutation. So all of them were having a trait of that, rather like a thalassemia trait. They were having only one gene defect, not both genes. And therefore, they never manifested except the patient. So this patient had heterozygous both. Whereas this one had only one gene heterozygous, other normal. Similarly here. So this is how the family looks. So this is Naksh. His parents had one defective gene each. And mother's side, the gene was this. Father's side, the gene was this. So and the father was causes of hemolysis in the newborn can be varied. Now you can imagine this child also had hemolysis in the neonatal period, and it was missed because nobody could test him for this kind of enzymopathy. But if there was availability of genetic testing in those days in 2013, maybe he would have got tested and he would have known what the disease is. And once they know what it is easier to manage, and the anxiety is lower, and the parents are counseled correctly about that particular disease. So in a newborn, you can have isoimmunization, which can be RH or ABO or minor group incompatibility. Then you can have enzymopathies, you can have membranopathies, you can have unstable hemoglobins and alpha thalassemias. You can have acquired defects due to infections, hemolysis can happen. Due to torches, you can have hemolysis. Due to certain infections and drugs, as well as vitamin E deficiency in preterms or osteopetrosis, also can lead to hemolytic type of anemia. Of course, as we discussed, isoimmunization can be due to immune drug-induced hemolytic anemia. Infection can lead to immune hemolysis. And certain congenital infections can cause hemolysis, and DIC can also have microangiopathic anemia. Now, impaired red cell production, which I told you, uncommon, and therefore we do not consider this as a differential easily in neonatal anemias. But you can have diamond black fan anemia diagnosed at birth because of the various anomalies they come with. They have thumb anomalies. Now here you have digitization of the thumb. That means it is like a finger. It is not separate perpendicular thumb. And it is triphalangeal. On X-ray, this baby had a triphalangeal. I may not be tested at birth. Then there are some hereditary disorders, refractory neonatal period, but they are uncommon, highly uncommon. So when you talk of neonatal anemias, you must remember, you must think of two main causes, hemorrhage and hemolysis, as we have demonstrated in the cases. Sometimes you can have congenital leukemia with huge liver, spleen, palpable testicular enlargement, and anemia with thrombocytopenia. Anemia of prematurity in a preterm baby, as such baby is pale because the hemoglobin DIC because of infections. So these babies, and letting down blood because we are going to do collections for doing various tests, that all can compound anemia in a preterm baby. But anemia of prematurity classically does not come in the neonatal period. It comes late. It comes generally by 4 weeks to 8 weeks. And it is caused because of decreased red cell mass, first of all, because the baby has been born fast. So the transfer of the red cell mass has not happened adequately. Decreased hematopoietic activity due to low EPO level, because the EPO is now being produced by liver and not kidney as yet. Kidney happens in the full-term baby. So when liver is producing EPO, the threshold for stimulating the bone marrow is much higher. And because of that, the baby's hematopoiesis is low. There is hemodilution. There are other nutritional contributory factors because mother cannot transfer the iron adequately, because that happens in last 3 months. There is vitamin E as one of the deficiencies, and folate. So one needs to supplement them with various nutrients. From very beginning, folate and vitamin E can be given, and iron can be started at 2 weeks. Iron causes oxidant injury, so you do not start in the first 2 weeks. So what is the role of erythropoietin? After birth, when respiration is established and oxygen delivery improves, there's a shutdown of EPO production and reduced hemoglobin production. And that leads to both physiologic anemia in the full term and preterms, the anemia of prematurity. But this is just one aspect. In the preterm, it is also because the EPO is not going to stimulate the marrow even at a threshold where in a full term it would have stimulated. So remember that. But giving erythropoietin from outside does not help. There are enough Cochrane reviews to say that erythropoietin doesn't work. Just supplement nutritionally and they will do well. So in, actually to give you a picture of what are the various causes of anemia at various times in a neonate. In intrauterine life, they can have hemolytic disease of newborn causing hydrops. Fetalis, you can have homozygous alpha thalassemia or maternal illness related anemia. Labor and delivery due to bleeds, various bleeds. Week one, again, bleeds can contribute, hemolytic anemia, congenital infections, bone marrow failure states occasionally, and so on and so forth. I'm not going into details, but look at this, physiologic anemia and anemia of prematurity, week six, both are senior. This, again, is in Nathanowski, so you can look it up if you wish to, whenever you have a patient, because every time you need to check out what is the cause. Someone is again marking with the marker. So if we have time, I will have put a few slides for neonatal transfusions and then wind up. Do we have that 10 minutes time?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I thought, because transfusions are so important in neonatal anemia, I thought we'll club it with this. So sick neonates are the most heavily transfused group of patients in modern medicine, as we all know. And neonatal transfusions are opinion-based rather than evidence-based most of the time. Most neonatologists do not prescribe drugs unless beneficial. But this rigor does not translate to prescription of blood products. They easily prescribe blood products. And in fact, when we did one blood audit in our hospital, in San Hospital, when I was there, we found that maximum misuse or inappropriate use of blood products is in NICU, followed by in general pediatrics. And if you see in NICU, maximum misuse is of FFP, but even PRCs are misused or inappropriately given. So we should be very careful when we are giving transfusions, because transfusion has one advantage but 100 hazards. And we never remember that unless we went through it. If we were to receive a transfusion, we would worry about HIV, hepatitis C, hepatitis B, prion protein disease, Jacob Creutzfeldt disease, all kinds of slow viruses, etc. In today's time, even COVID, we are not sure whether it is transmitted. So far, there is no such evidence, but it could be. I don't know. So there are a lot of things which are wrongly done because we do not strictly adhere to the evidence. What are the indications for red cell transfusions in neonates? Of course, this is just to tell you how antigens and antibodies are present in different blood groups. I think all of us are aware of this. And what samples should be sent for testing? Up to first 4 months of life, always send baby and mother both samples, because mother sample is required for atypical antibody screen. That helps. And in neonate sample, we do the group. We also do the antibody screen in the baby, but if mother's sample is not available. So what kind of red cells you will use for exchange transfusion? You use group O so that there is no antigen, or ABO compatible with maternal and neonatal plasma, because the antibodies should not break the RBCs. Or you give Rh negative, again there is no antigen, or Rh identical with the neonate. So if Rh positive baby, you can give Rh positive. Now, IAT, indirect antiglobulin test compatible with maternal plasma, is important, because finally antibodies in the baby are those which are present in the maternal plasma. So that's why you do the compatibility with maternal plasma, and all plasma should be maternal compatible. So blood should be less than 5 days old for exchange transfusion. It should be CPD coagulant, CMV sero negative preferably, irradiated if intrauterine transfusion has been given earlier, or transfused within 24 hours, and should be transfused within 24 hours of irradiation. Hematocrit should not be more than 60%. Now, indications: asymptomatic baby with hemoglobin less than 7 grams and with low retic count, symptomatic anemia with hemoglobin less than 10 gram percent, on ventilation or oxygen by mask, with apnea, bradycardia, tachycardia, poor weight gain, with hemoglobin less than 12 gram percent if on ventilation and oxygen mask, with a more than 35% FiO2, and with hemoglobin less than 15 gram percent if they are congenital cyanotic heart diseases or on ECMO. So these are the indications for RBC transfusions. How do you select donors? You should not give any patient, any newborn baby blood donated by anybody who has not been previously a donor. So within the previous 2 years, if the donor has been negative for all mandatory microbiology markers, then you can use. And you should try and use aliquots from a single donation for repeated transfusions within the shelf life of the packed red cells. So do not expose the baby to multiple donors if not required. You irradiate specially in preterms who have received intrauterine transfusion. If they have not received intrauterine transfusion, even preterms don't need irradiated blood. Preferably CMV negative if the recipient is seronegative, which is very uncommon in our situation because 95% of our population is seropositive. And leukocyte depletion should be done always in every transfusion that is given to a neonate. So in short, how would you approach a neonate with anemia? Of course, history is crucial. You must take a detailed history. Family history, obstetric history is important. Placental examination is important. Examine the baby and then do a CBC and then a retic count. If retic count is low, you think of various conditions as mentioned here. I'm not going into details because here, first of all, this is high retic count, not low. So anemia of prematurity, isoimmunization, diamond black fan anemia, drug-induced red cell suppression. Erythropoietic suppression or other bone marrow suppression. But if retic is normal or high, do a Coombs test. If Coombs positive, look at isoimmunization. If Coombs negative, look at MCV. If MCV low, then chronic blood loss or thalassemias. If MCV is normal or high, then think of isoimmunization and an acute blood loss. Look at peripheral smear. Look at presence of spherocytes, hereditary elliptocytosis, all the hereditary conditions, hemoglobinopathies. And if it's nearly normal, then think of blood loss and hemolysis. Hemolysis, congenital RBC enzyme defects, and bacterial infections, other infections, and isoimmunization. So this is a chart again given in Nathanorsky. One can refer to whenever one has a baby. So what are the key messages I'd like to give through this talk is, neonatal anemias are mainly due to hemorrhage or hemolysis, very rarely bone marrow failures. Nutritional anemias are extremely rare in neonates. Approach the baby rationally. Baseline investigations should first be done. Sophisticated investigations should be the next step. Maintain a blood lead chart in the NICU so that you know iatrogenically how much blood is being taken away. Do not use blood products if not indicated, if alternatives are available. Follow suitable guidelines applicable to the center concerned for transfusions. Transfuse only what and how much is required as per evidence in literature. I think this is extremely important. Do not transfuse unnecessarily, because every transfusion, I had a baby was transfused FFP and then came to us for HIV infection. And there was no other source of HIV in that baby. Mother was negative, father was negative. And this baby was infected, and this baby followed up with us from 2 years of age onwards. Exchange transfusion was done in another baby who was infected. This was a baby who received FFP for DIC in newborn period. Both patients died in front of our eyes, and we felt so bad because those days ART was not easily available. So do not transfuse unless really mandatory. Take an opinion if required from a pediatric hematologist before transfusing if you are in doubt. If very clear, please go ahead. So this is what I want to tell you all. Again, I thank my team. Because of them, I can function, I can work, and they help me. They multiply the successes. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, madam, for such elaborative, comprehensive, and very, very useful, very knowledgeable lecture. Everybody must be finding it very useful during their day-to-day practice also.
Thank you.
And because this is blessing in disguise, because even though we are facing corona things, but your lectures are finding very useful for
thank
us.
Thank you. Thank you.
And, this is third lecture. Everybody is very much happy and satisfied with so much knowledge they're getting.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, madam. And hereafter also, as much as
sure, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you, madam, for your excellent lecture. It is very useful for the...
Yeah. So there is one question. What's the prognosis in the baby who received IVIG and steroids for SLE in mother? We gave her steroids and they both did well, and they were following up in the rheumat OPD. The baby became all right completely by about 3 months. Did not require any management beyond that, because by and large the antibody would wane off by 3 months. The mother had to be given treatment long term, and she also did well. She went into complete remission. So both did well. Any other questions?
You are presenting one case or not?
Yeah, they were having some case. Your audio is not okay, Preeti.
I think there is some kind of a network issue. With
Dr. Preeti?
Ma'am, do you have a time present case? Hello, sir.
Hello.
Yeah, short presentation we can make.
Yes, yes. Ma'am, the case will be presented by Dr. Vijay Mali, sir. He's a neonatologist. So I request Dr. Vijay Mali, sir, to share his screen.
Yeah.
Vijay Mali sir?
Yeah.
So it's a short case.
Yeah.
Just for the interaction and.
Yeah. Okay.
Shall I start now?
Please begin. Please begin.
First of all, it was very nice lecture and good to hear from madam as well. And what a practical use we got from madam's lecture. And
thank you.
It's not much different from madam's lectures. Simple. But fortunately, I got here the same patient admitted a couple of days back. So I thought it was good to say. So this antenatal history, mother is 26 years.
You can put it in presentation mode.
The mother is 26, second gravida, no significant maternal medical or surgical illness. Pregnancy was uneventful otherwise. All ANC scans were normal. Came at 39 weeks for decreased fetal movements and abdominal pain 5 hours before the delivery. And history of mild nausea, vomiting and weakness on the same day morning, that is early in the morning, she noted some nausea, vomiting, weakness, and backache. So soon after admission, obstetrician did the NST, non-stress test. And here the heart rate, fetal heart rate was consistently 180 and above with some decelerations, which is quite unusual. Normally there will be accelerations, no decelerations, and heart rate is up to 160. The green mark on the strip is that is what expected. And so they advised immediate scan, antenatal scan by radiologist. And the radiologist reported it is completely normal.
Okay.
But still, mother continues to tell that there's some pain and she definitely feels there is decreased fetal movement. So they did repeat, this was 11:30 in the morning NST, and they repeated one more NST at 4 in the evening. I just marked it. So here again, the NST was like 180. Fetal heart rate with some deceleration. So the obstetrician was really worried and we saw this one. So we decided we'll take for immediate cesarean section. So it was delivered because anesthetic was there. So it was, so this section was done within 15 minutes and noted to have meconium stain liker at delivery. So baby was definitely under some stress. So postnatally, male is 3.2 kg, baby cried soon after birth, good cry, tone and activity, apgars were 9, 10 and 10. So at 15 minutes, just baby, because of meconium, I observed baby for 15, 20 minutes usually. So no distress, there was some acrosinosis, so there was a warmer, so we kept under warmer. Heart rate was 180, but baby was crying, so I thought it will settle down. So good peripheral pulses, so systemic examination normal with no anomalies, so kept under warmer and then shifted to mother's side. Okay. On second day, so baby was, he took around 6 feeds, and usually the hospital, they have practice with mother, like packed milk with sugar and water, and then passed urine.
Not a good practice.
Not good practice, madam. We have a lot of difficulties as well.
But even if it's a cesarean, you can breastfeed easily. If the baby was okay, you should breastfeed.
Yeah, but...
If the baby was sick, I would understand.
We try to convince, madam. We try sooner or later, definitely we'll be on this.
Yeah.
Last urine and stool. Parents noted baby is not feeding well and remains sleepy with mild grunting. That was noted after 18 hours. So, on examination, very pale looking child. We cry with minimal grunting. Temperature was 30, so it was not definitely hypothermic. Capillary refill time was less than 2 seconds, so definitely not in like severe shock or something. All peripheral pulses well fed with bounding pulses. Heart rate that time was 210. So saturation check was 96. Systemic examination normal with soft anterior fontanelle. So immediately looking at this, this is the baby picture. Definitely after starting oxygen, but was much looking much paler than this. And then on admission, that was just minimal distress, saturations were well maintained and grunting. Definitely there was a tachypnea. So, and then this was the X-ray we did on admission. There was no cardiomegaly, and on examination there was no hepatosplenomegaly as well.
But if you see in the X-ray,
yeah,
this go to the X-ray.
Yes.
In the X-ray, the liver and spleen both look little bigger.
Yeah.
I cannot mark and show, but my arrow won't be seen. You can't see my arrow I'm putting.
Yeah,
You, yeah, that liver is little enlarged, even the spleen is little enlarged.
I could feel this.
Maybe baby's tachypneic also, so yes. It is pushed down.
I thought otherwise it was normal 3.2 kg child.
Yeah.
So, and then a few thoughts came in our mind at that time. Pallor, tachycardia, tachycardia.
But you are sure at immediately after birth there was no pallor?
Yes, ma'am, because it was meconium stain liker.
So it was difficult to make out.
And then when clean, we kept under warmer. Baby was healthy and crying. So I thought it's just normal. And I was worried about the tachycardia. When born, it was meconium.
Okay.
So I thought it was just the distress, maybe tachycardia and maybe meconium. So all these things, I thought we need to monitor for pulmonary hypertension. That was in my mind. And
okay.
So I kept initially could be SVT, supraventricular tachycardia. So we maybe started in a trend, hypertension, persistent pulmonary hypertension, and there was meconium. In the septic shock, even the pulses were good because we always think this could be the heart disease. And the last could be anemia. We had this anemia early stage. Then first ECG was done, just sinus tachycardia, 180 beats per minute. That was on admission.
But didn't you do a CBC first?
Yeah, we have sent, but CBC comes after 1 hour.
So meanwhile, all this was done. Yeah, I mean, if you evaluated CBC, you would probably not require to do this workup.
What happened?
There was no murmur, right?
No murmur, nothing.
Yeah.
Just the first thought we did, and CBC.
Yeah, yeah.
And maybe she was some metabolic acidosis, but this ABC was not metabolic acidosis.
Your voice is. So hemoglobin was 6.1, that's very low. MCV is 109, so it's near normal. So again, this is acute blood loss. Macrocytosis, that means normoblastemia was present probably.
Almost done, madam.
No, so I was just asking a certain question. So this looks like an acute bleed. There's no question in my mind.
Yes.
And we should have probably had the obstetrician tell us how the placenta was, whether there was a retroplacental clot. And a Cleor Betke would help us because then you would know from the mother's blood. But you couldn't do it, I believe.
Cleor Betke, we have done, actually there was no test here. We asked in lab. There was no, that kit not available. So here doctor, one of the good pathologists, he said, why can't we do electrophoresis on mother's blood?
Yeah, that's a surrogate method. But how much was the HbF in? So it goes up to 3 to 4 or 5%. It doesn't go very high, but sometimes you can have a little high hemoglobin F in a normal person, up to 3%. 5.8 is high.
Yes, ma'am.
So maybe you can consider this as a surrogate marker for fetal maternal bleed.
Yes, ma'am.
So we did, how did you manage? Yeah.
Then what I did, because initially we gave a normal saline bolus. And then subsequently we just cube packed cell volume. Initially, because baby was much stable, okay. So I gave like 10 ml per kg for 4 hours with Lasix, and we repeated one more blood after 24 hours, and the hemoglobin has increased to 15.9.
So when you give transfusion of packed red cells, there is no need to give Lasix.
Okay.
Ever. Even if they are in cardiac failure, you have to reduce the rate of transfusion and not give Lasix.
Okay, madam.
Yeah, there is
no neonates, madam. We tend to because we continue the IV.
You show me evidence. You show me evidence. Okay.
All right.
There's no evidence. Okay.
We don't restrict the fluid, so I thought we'll give the Lasix.
No need. In fact, you substitute the blood for the fluid, no?
Yes.
So then you will be taking care of it, and don't transfuse more than 3 to 5 cc's per kg initially.
Okay, madam.
So once the hemodynamic stability happens afterwards, then you can give 10 cc's later after, say, about 12 hours. So in the morning, you give 5 ml per kg and wait. And after 12 hours, you can give 10 ml per kg if you want to give further. If you don't want to give with 5 ml, if baby becomes stable, leave the baby alone and start the baby on iron now after 2 weeks.
Okay. And madam, what, like when we do this transfusion, especially in other babies, we are all the time worried about falling of the sugar because we don't give for 3-4 hours any fluids. Hypoglycemia could be the other risk. So what will be continue fluids as well, and then meantime we get the last.
So if you are concerned about hypoglycemia, I'm not too sure whether it will cause hypoglycemia when blood is going on, because blood itself contains solutions which release glucose.
Okay.
So I don't think it will cause, but in case you are concerned, you may give a bolus before and after.
Okay, madam. Yeah.
That will be easier to manage.
Yes, madam. And madam, other concern is because here we give only leukodepleted but not irradiated blood.
That's fine. That's fine, because irradiated is, you know, by latest guidelines of 2011, that is the latest available guidelines by British Committee of Standards in Hematology. They have recommended only if you have given intrauterine transfusions, then you need to continue irradiated transfusions for at least 6 months postnatally.
Okay.
But if you have not given intrauterine transfusions, then TA-GVHD is not a common complication even in newborns. Okay. Earlier, we used to say it is common to have problems if you don't give irradiated, but now they don't recommend. And leukodepletion is very important, because then you're taking care of CMV also, and majorly the TA-GVHD related reactions also will be lower.
They do CBNAT testing, like they do extended screening.
Yes.
Is it because its cost will be added, like 1,000 or 1,200 extra for that? Is it worth using that? Because they claim it is best.
So, except for HCV, where it reduces the window period significantly, for HIV and hepatitis B, it does not really reduce the window period significantly. So, there is still a chance that you may be missing the patient, the blood which may be actually infected for HIV and for hepatitis B. But for HCV, it definitely reduces the window period significantly. But even if it is not significant reduction in window period for HIV and HBsAg, I would still say it is reduction. So worthwhile spending that money for preventing infections in the baby.
Okay. And then one more last silly question I have.
They're not like silly questions. They're never silly. Answers can be silly.
Madam, like when we get the PCV, we tend to have, like we work in government hospital, there we used to keep that PCV in the fridge, used in the second day like
never.
That. Now we are not doing
never
that.
Do that. It is not safe. It is not right. You want aliquot, ask aliquot from the blood bank. If you can't get aliquot, discard the remaining. You cannot keep in fridge and reuse. You will cause bacterial contamination. You will cause hemolysis. You will cause all kinds of problems, because a blood bank refrigerator is a regulated refrigerator. Whereas here, you will keep in any compartment and there will be so many other things lying around. So contamination is a big deal. So don't do that. Always ask for aliquots if you can get from your blood bank. Tell them to collect the donor packed red cells in penta bag, so they can give you aliquots of 10 ml, 15 ml, even 30 ml, depending on the weight of the baby. That is a better way of, or don't discard. It's worth discarding the blood. It's worth wasting the blood. It's worth exposing the baby to more donors rather than using the blood kept in a fridge in the ward.
Okay.
It's 15 hours.
While transfusion, madam, I have seen, because the unit where I was working, we used to have that like there was some equipment, used to go through that, used to keep warm.
That is an inline blood warmer.
We are not using
it. No, it is not required for normal healthy babies or normal children. Uh-huh. It is required for those who have cold antibodies.
Okay.
Only in those children we require, which is very rare.
Okay.
It is very rare to have paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria in a child. It is commoner in adults. So therefore, it is almost always not required in our cases.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Pranam. And then the rest of my slides are just like what happens when there is antenatal, like fetal anemia. There's like sinusoidal pattern, like Dopplers are very important, NST yes. changes, and middle cerebral artery flow changes. And then like whenever we face such situation, it is good to keep O negative blood ready for immediate transfusion.
I have a question to you, Vijay. In such a baby where you had NST changes and mother was complaining of abdominal pain and yes, reduced fetal movements, wouldn't you do a cord CBC, cord blood CBC, so that at birth itself you come to know what's the level of hemoglobin?
Because the baby was crying soon after birth and was very much comfortable. Okay. If baby like any lethargy or
then you would have
asphyxia,
done.
Usually we do one cord for documentation, acidosis to the baby.
Okay.
And so I thought, and here there was no, because Doppler was done 2 hours before in radio diagnostic center. They said it's perfectly normal.
Okay.
So obstetrician said you can go home. But okay. mother said that I'm not feeling good. I want to stay here.
Thank God.
And she was still.
So and you would have
today,
lost the baby.
Assessing that child.
Oh, very good. Very good. Good, good. Good case.
Thank
yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well managed.
Yeah. There is one question from Dr. Amit Saxena, sir. Is it yeah. correct to transfuse via infusion pump?
No, I have answered to him. No, you cannot transfuse via infusion pump. You have to use a blood transfusion set because it has microaggregate filter that will take away the debris of platelets and leukocytes that may form in the blood, or microclots if they are formed in the blood. So you should never use infusion pump because first of all, it will be very difficult. You can't regulate the rate of blood because it's thick. It's not like fluid where you can regulate the number of drops as you want. Okay. Any
Thank
other?
You, ma'am. Okay. Thank you for such an informative.
Thank you very much.